I had got cast in The Accidental Tourist, and I was terrified. It was like the biggest, most important thing that had ever happened to me, and I just wanted somebody to reassure me that I would know what I was doing when I finally got there. I had wanted this part so desperately from when I first, I read the book when it came out, actually, and I thought, oh, somebody's gonna get to play this part and I'm gonna be so jealous. And then when it was me, I freaked out.
And I went to this little house and watched this man teach, and I thought, well, no big thing. Feels comfortable, feel kind of safe. I'll try it. And it just so happened that I had come upon a genius.
I was going up for movies, and it was always down to me and like two other girls, me and two other girls, me and one other girl. And they would say, you know, the other girl's just better. She's just better. You need a teacher. You need a teacher. You've got to get a teacher. And this guy said, I've got this teacher. He's just the best. He's just the best. But he was so expensive. You go to this guy, and he doesn't completely change your life, I'll pay for every class you take. And I thought, wow, that's a pretty big recommendation.
Let's see, I'm 6'4". He must have been about 6-ish, 5'11-ish.
I always see him from a low angle. Whenever I imagine him, I never imagine him like face to face like this. I always imagine like looking up at him.
I'm about 5 feet. But this wide.
Big and round.
Not the tallest guy in the world.
Somewhere between 5'6" and 6 feet, depending on what he was talking about.
Is that possible? Something like that. And you know.
Soft, doughy.
Roly-poly.
I don't want to say roly-poly because he was robust. He was strong, you know. He was firm, but he was a big guy.
Very compact, not fat. He would have thought he was fat.
He'd always wear shorts.
He always wore a green jacket.
Usually in like gray or brown.
Always seemed to wear white.
His black t-shirt. Kind of plaid.
He was a schlub.
There was nothing schlubby about
him.
Very
fastidious.
He always had a little bit of food on him.
He was cultured.
Roy was vulgar.
He answered you intelligently and fully.
I mean, it would leave a taste in your mouth.
Forget about a teacher. I thought he was perfect.
How was his hair? His hair was sort of...
Beautiful hair. And that, I mean, I think it was his hair.
Roy's bald.
So not so much hair here, but I think he was kind of hirsute in the arms.
Shiny head, big beard.
A very intellectual, happy Santa.
A Zen-like, very enlightened Donna Tefka from Fiddler on the Roof, who has this wisdom, has this bravado and this power. Yet would break out in song if he needed to.
The impact he made he was just a force.
Incredibly animated. All the time.
I remember Roy more as a hurricane of 79 or something. It's just like, it was more like an experience.
You didn't notice even his physicality as much as his presence.
A sailor.
A wood nymph.
A lion.
Half munchkin, half Buddha.
The Tasmanian devil.
Mischievous gnome.
Rabbinical.
Like a big teddy bear with no hair.
To say he was a teddy bear would kind of... He was just someone you wanted to get in there and embrace.
Roy always resembled a light bulb.
You know, that was on. That was just, you know, a beacon.
We all projected so many things on him that it's hard to describe him. I mean, you can describe him physically, but that doesn't tell you anything about the guy.
I can't use words to really describe what he looked like.
Like if I was gonna, in front of a police sketch artist now, I would mess it up.
I don't think I could describe physical characteristics, but he just had love emanating from his face.
Roy looked like love. Is it possible that someone can look like love? His face was just love. And when he smiled, I always loved when he smiled.
There is no correct in film acting. It doesn't exist. It isn't relevant. There is in a certain kind of acting. You know, a lot of child actors, when I meet them, I don't teach children, but ex-child actors, are very confused because they were rewarded as children for the opposite of what makes really good film acting. That means do everything right. This is an angry line, do it angry. Hit your mark perfectly. Show up and just be a good boy or a good girl. And of course, as an adult, somewhere around 20, that is not what it's about. It's about your vision, your need and bringing your entire life to bear on your work, to the extent of what the work is about. You may not bring your entire life, but to bring your life. Sometimes certain roles require more, but all of them require that you're bringing where you're at as a man, a woman, a citizen, an American, a person in society. It's not in a vacuum.
He wanted to be thought of as someone who would redefine acting.
This was a man with a gifted IQ.
As a child, he was a whiz kid. He was a math genius, and he was on the radio in New York City. There's a great spread in Life magazine of him at, I think, about 5 or 6 years old, telling a story, a rather ludicrous story, about Mickey Mouse marrying Donald Duck. And there's 6 pictures of Roy telling a story, and it's odd, not odd, it's wonderful, because it physically looks exactly the same way he moved when he was telling stories as an adult.
He graduated high school, I think, at 15 or 16, and he was in college by that age, and out of college before he was 20 and starring on Broadway.
Roy never had one of those waiter, starving actor jobs. He went right to work as an actor.
He was an ingenue.
It was at a particular time in the theater and in movies where you were expected to look a certain way.
He had a certain charisma.
Off-Broadway stuff.
Cast as Holden Caulfield.
Some Broadway things.
His first part in a Broadway show. A Jules Pfeiffer play, Little Murder.
Whole series of plays at Playwrights Horizons.
He worked at the Royal Shakespeare Company in England with Peter Brook.
Old Moss Hart. Peter Bogdanovich directed.
On stage, he was like he was in life, full of energy, full of physical activity. Roy was very physical.
Always alive. There was always something going on. You just paid attention. I thought he was wonderful.
He was a natural-born character actor.
They sent me to a shrink. He said I was still reacting to my childhood. See, my mother hated me, so I went to live with my father. I really liked him, but after a couple of months, he left town and changed his name. Can't understand why. The shrink said I turn everyone I meet into a father figure. Then when they reject me, I want to kill them.
If I had projected into the future what I thought he would be, it would have been something like that, something like a really fine supporting actor, but not a star. I don't think he wanted to be a star. I mean, he turned out he was.
When you're young, you must learn to be a professional, whatever your field is, whatever it is. It's important. I don't like amateurs. Professional, you know, that you're excellent at what you do. However, that's not the end. Once you're a professional, it's almost like getting there is important. Once you're there, you have to get somewhere else. In my classroom, where I work with actors, which I hold very sacred, is a laboratory. It's a laboratory for understanding stuff, figuring things out.
Roy wasn't at all interested in certain conventional techniques. He had an assumption that if you were in his class, you already knew this stuff.
We get annoyed at people who were like if you were locked in anything, if you're locked into method, he's like, well, method could work a lot, but it's not going to work every time. Why stay married to that? What's the point? What are you, method guy, or are you an actor?
He used to say in class that the certain parts of method acting were really important during the 50s when people were very stiff, and if they were upset, they put the hand up here, or, you know, that they had all this kind of mannerisms to show emotion. And he said, you know, and then the method came around and just shook actors out of that and just kind of, you know, forced real emotional life into performances. And he said it was really valuable. But at the time he was teaching, he said, but everybody knows that now. And he goes, every soap opera, everyone's hyping themselves into some kind of emotional life, but there wasn't any truth to it.
The idea that you would express how you felt, that you would be willing to do that, was very exciting. I don't think that's true now. I think that the danger of expressing how you feel, honestly, is not the danger it was. People, like everything else in our society, people co-opt, it gets co-opted, and it becomes coin of the realm. So now, whereas in 1955, if that's the right year, to say, I'm so unhappy about what Lois has done to me, for a man to say that was dangerous. Now, everyone, you go into your dry cleaner and you say, how's it going? Oh, my wife left me for a lesbian lover and my penis is too small. Could you look at it? You look like a man about town. Does it look normal? And people are shameless. And it's the way they win friends and influence people is through expressing their emotion. I think now there's other things that are dangerous and necessary, which is to change the world, to make your vision
It's a very exciting time for acting because that idea of your vision, I think, is what we need now. This is the first time since I've been an adult that if you go into the street and ask someone, how's it going, they say horrible. They always had a reason, the 50s, the 60s, 70s, the 80s, of why really it was okay. That's over.
You gotta throw all the old rules out. If you come from the method school of acting, blah, 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 get rid of it. We have a new mandate here, you know, obligation to come at this much more aggressively with whatever we got in whatever way we can to make something come alive.
The problem is figuring out what the scene's about. You know, if you're supposed to be sad in a scene, that's what you think is supposed to be happening in the scene, is I have to act sad here. You're wrong.
When I started, Roy said all the scenes were about love, power, death, and money. But I think later, money and power became the same thing.
He would always say that scenes are either love or power.
Every moment in life and every scene is about love or power. I thought there were quite a few more than that, but when you define each moment in your life or in a character's life, it takes you back to that. You're looking for something at all times.
Everything in life, even in regular conversations, everybody was always trying to get something.
What are your needs? What's your character's needs? How are they going to get their needs met? How are they going to do that? Because they'll do anything they have to do to get those needs met.
If one thing wouldn't work, he would try another thing.
He'll talk, he'll listen, he'll dance, he'll strip, whatever it is. There's no end to what you will do.
And if one thing fails, you take another road and you do another thing.
This doesn't work, throw it away, do the next thing. This doesn't work, throw it away, do the next thing.
Know what you're going for in the scene, then you can just be that way. You can just be and be natural. It'll be natural to you in the scene. So that's what he taught. So that's not acting.
Roy used to say, don't act the scene that the writer wrote. Act the scene that the writer was trying to write. The writer didn't mean to write this scene. The writer thought they were writing this scene out of Shakespeare, this scene out of Eugene O'Neill. Figure out what they were trying to write and act that instead.
Somehow Roy London found a way to take the worst television scripts and find the humanity in them.
There's no time on the set for any of that to happen, to sit down and have that kind of a discussion with the director. And it would be great if you could.
Most directors of film are that specific about the acting beats, you know, about what's going on, about the emotional content or track of a character. You know, there's so many things that they're dealing with.
I've learned to trust no director. Except for a couple in my life.
Directors are ordinarily very, very indulgent. If you say, I really don't think I should say this, what if I say X instead? They're usually completely fine with it. But he always, always wanted to try to make the written line work.
What can we do to make this one line of dialogue in the scene really matter? And he had a passion for that has rarely been matched.
I had a hard time with the scene where I, as Alabama, Clarence goes and kills my pimp Drexel and comes back.
I killed him.
I'm a hamburger, so I'm a fucking starving to death.
Is this a joke?
No joke.
And I say, oh, you're so romantic. What you did was so romantic. I had a really hard time just with my own morality being able to say that and commit to that. And he was saying, well, you know, when maybe one way you can look at that is when you become a killer, you change. He is a killer and he's different and he's now possibly dangerous to you.
Christ, he's not worth one of your tears.
So if that's a manipulation you're saying to him or whatever, this guy is a murderer and he has to believe you so you don't die. If that's what it is, that's fine. If it's a big lie, that scene for you, because he's a killer, that's fine.
I think what you did was...
What?
I think what you did...
What?
...was so romantic.
It's wonderful to put on another set of clothes and look in the mirror and go, wow, that's a character. That's not me. And, but the whole key he kept getting into is you can't be anything but who you are in that moment.
You know how I feel about this interview that I don't want to be...
I work with a lot of people and I want to leave that private. But if you get, let's say, an actor who's very big and and then you say, what is the root of it? It's because they feel little, not because they feel big. So meanwhile, other actors or actresses are going in front of their mirrors practicing how to be big when they should practice how little they feel, and then they'll probably get big. But see that risk that that takes? If I go in front of my mirror and I practice how to be big, and then I go and get on the set and start behaving the way I practiced, then I know what I'm gonna do. Good or bad, I have some sense I know what I'm gonna do. Whereas if I say, probably the reason this person is so kind of vulgar and thing is because they feel they're not seen, they feel they're not experienced, they need to be experienced, I'm going to go from the root of someone who feels not experienced and see what that does to me. You're not sure how that's all going to turn out.
He told this story that in On the Waterfront, Brando had told Rod Steiger that a brother would never pull a gun on another brother. He didn't need that. That the tools that a brother has against another brother is so much more powerful than a gun. You know, because you know all the buttons to press, and you don't need a gun. So they spoke about it, and they talked to the director, and they said, look, we don't want to have him pull out the gun in the back of the car. It's just, a brother doesn't need the gun, and it's not realistic. So they said, you're right, let's, you know. And so time went by, and they went to go shoot the scene. And just before the scene, the director said to Rod, pull out the gun. So in the scene, it's a great moment, because he pulls out the gun on Brando, and Brando's reaction isn't fear, or oh my God, I have a gun. His reaction is, I can't believe they put the fucking gun in there. I told him not to put the, this is unbelievable to me. There's a gun, he's pointing a gun at me. And then he goes on with the scene. And it was so truthful. And it was so honest. And even within the scene, it's honest that he can't believe his brother would point a gun at him. That's a moment of reality that he was trying to get to.
The reason why I was drawn to acting was I thought I'd get to be different people besides myself. I was drawn to being other characters. And Roy really brought home to me that actually, much to my chagrin at the time, actually acting is exposing yourself who you really are in front of everyone in a very intimate way.
I never met Roy in person. Everything was on the telephone, but, you know, but Roy is so intense. You know, this voice would be coming at me over the telephone almost assaultively with such confidence and such passion. I said to myself, who the hell is this? The thing that connected both of us was, I hate to say a theory of personality, but it's almost like a certain vision or a certain sensibility about the human soul. So what he would say is, especially would say if you really want to have power as an actor, what he would define as a star is somebody who basically not only could reveal the parts of themselves that normally most people wouldn't want to reveal to other people in public, but enjoy revealing them and think that other people would actually be interested.
I think that Joan Crawford is an interesting person because some of the roles she played were not nice people. And I think that a lesson to be culled from that is that if your essence is, if you know what it is, if you see what your gifts are, it doesn't matter whether they're attractive or not. They become, by definition, attractive if they're your gifts. If there's something that is antisocial in the world, I suggest you don't follow them and do it. I mean, if you have the instincts of a murderer, I think it's a very good idea not to murder anyone. It's against the law, and it hurts innocent people. But if that's what you have, not to suggest that she does, but if that's what you have, then when you're acting in motion pictures, you must use that. And I think that it's exciting, whatever it is. We're not talking that your gifts or your essence has to be something wonderful and lovely. It just has to be. And I think Joan Crawford very strongly, that ambition and that a kind of a you will not cross me is clearly there.
You can't go in and fool around and do it like, you know, so everybody on the set thinks you're not really bad girl. You know, you can show the crew that, like, you know, I'm playing somebody who's bad, but, you know, craft service people, you know I'm a nice girl, right? You can't do that when you go to work on a movie.
The extent that the actor is able to bring their soul closer to their skin, I don't know. You know, that they are willing, very few people are they willing to be, to tap into what it is they are?
Most people can't do that. Now that part of yourself that you'd rather other people didn't see is called a shadow. Shadow is the part of yourself you wish you were not.
I couldn't have done Basic Instinct because if I hadn't been working with Roy, because I wouldn't have had the confidence to tell that truth.
Shadow is the part of yourself you wish that other people did not see, so naturally you hide it.
I got that part because 13 other actresses turned it down, not because they wanted me. That was scary business.
When I began to open up that curtain, sort of like who the guy really is in The Wizard of Oz, it's just the guy who shits and disappoints and lies sometimes and cheats and steals and does everything short of literally murdering someone. If I go there, I'm more likely to get a job.
Roy was really involved with things being out of control.
The moment that you might be able to identify in the performance, the defining, just hot fucking on fire moment, is probably, if you had asked the actor right after the take, that was the moment that they were distracted or that somebody dropped something over there. And the whole activity of acting was released for a moment and they could just be.
He made you feel like whatever happened, just go with it.
It sounds like when you go into an acting class that you're setting up all these rules, all these little things, these parts of the craft.
You have to know all that stuff.
And you do. You set them all up in rehearsal.
But then the great actors know it all and then just throw it away.
Throw them away.
Throw it away. And they're brave enough the moment they're in a scene to just say to themselves, I have no idea where I'm going or what I'm going to do. But I'm confident enough that I've done all my homework and I'm prepared and everything, but I'm just gonna do it.
Sometimes when I'm working with an actor and they're having trouble with something, and they'll suddenly go, I can't do this, they feel horrible. I go, oh, thank God. As soon as that feeling comes out, I know now it's just details. It's when someone goes, I'm gonna be fine, everything's great, and that nothing's going to happen. There'll be no growth, there's no potential. Everything's about potential, and the moving into that potential, and then the new potential and that moves beyond that.
So you're getting into a kind of a paradoxical or a contradictory state where the person has to work very hard and be very disciplined and use tools, but the purpose of the tools are not to control the outcome, not to control people's reactions, not even to control what's created. The purpose of the tools is to take away control.
It wasn't enough that you might make a scene work. If he saw any amount of control, he would still call you on it.
He wanted me to go to that place of being honest, way beyond what I think is honest, or where I'm willing to go, to live in that shortness of breath place.
Not to be so tight and frightened and shut down and like a performing seal.
Wouldn't tell you how to do it, and that pissed me off because I wanted to be told. I wanted instruction. But he would make me instruct myself. He would make me find it for myself.
Roy had a wonderful ability to get people to go to the edge.
Roy was great at saying, you have to be courageous.
There are certain teachers that demand that, and Roy was able to.
What is the worst thing that could happen to you? What do you think is going to happen if you completely let it rip?
Brilliance completely happens by accident, but you can set the stage for it, for the possibility of it happening.
There was a scene where I was drove up right into the front yard, smashed the mm-hmm. car three or four times, then drove up into the front yard. And I remember saying to Marty, I'd like to, when I get out of the car, I'd like to fall down before I go in the house. And I remember him saying, all right, to the cameraman, can you back up and hold her falling down? Because we were really moving fast. And he said, yeah, yeah. Bob said, yeah. And they backed up really fast. And I said, all right, I'm just going to try it. And he said, what's going to happen? I said, I don't know. And I got out of the car, and it was comedic and scary all at the same time. I fell down, and I got up, and I kept going. And there was something about the movement of it that was very intense.
Stop.
Don't you threaten me!
When you're willing to create a space that accidents are okay and accidents work and accidents make things better, then you're living in the extraordinary.
It's almost like he taught people about what life is like, you know? That you really have to do what's real, not your little preconceived actor notions of what's going on.
For me, getting it was understanding that it wasn't about TV and it wasn't about film and it wasn't about commercials. It was about life.
Roy put me back on a journey that just honestly transformed my life and transformed my whole approach to who I want to be in this world. Not this picture of who I want to be.
Now, there isn't anyone I know personally, in biographies I read, who has achieved anything worthwhile. And by that, I don't necessarily mean a great relationship, a great novel, a great acting performance, a great child, who hasn't almost died at some point, either physically, psychologically, or emotionally, who hasn't crashed into a sense of I don't know where I am, and then through that found a little more of who they were, you know? That's why sometimes when I work with actors, I guess, which is really all I know, I don't, you know, stuff about life, who knows, but that when that confusion and stuff starts to happen, that's when I go, good, there now will be growth. We all wish that it could just be a nice, easy, straight line up in everything we do, and I don't need to tell you that as much as we wish it were that, it isn't, you know? So that sometimes that confusion and disorientation and hell, later on, we look back on it, we go, my God, that's where it all began.
He was in a play at La Mama. It was a benefit evening because the fire department was going to shut down La Mama if they didn't pay $25. And of course, no one had $25. So about 30 playwrights wrote 10-minute plays, and Roy had a monologue, and which was just delicious. And I don't remember a thing about it, but it was, except that it was wonderful. And I came up to him and said, you were absolutely fabulous. And he said, I love your work. And we went home and slept together. You know, I mean, that was like all in about 2 hours. He was going to Uta Hagen's class. He would come back to the house and say, and do the entire lesson. It was just remarkable. I just sat there and got the entire class. It took an hour and a half usually. I actually learned a hell of a lot from him just repeating what had happened in the class. I went, oh God, well, I'll know not to do that, won't I? Even in writing.
I met him in a workshop that was run by Joseph Chaykin with a company called the Open Theater. And Roy would come up with one idea after another.
And the work he did later may not have resembled it stylistically, but the link seems really clear. And that what Roy did with his every breath as a teacher and a coach was radical. It was completely, pardon the cliche, outside the box.
I think a lot of people were not taking the usual route towards living out one's life as an actor. People condescended to Hollywood.
Interestingly enough, we didn't go to the movies together that much. Because, you know, we were 26 and interested in the theater, and movies were like banal, terrible, plebeian crap, you know. We went to the theater, which of course was really banal, plebeian crap, but we didn't know that.
The only thing that really mattered in those days was avant-garde, new ideas. He didn't quite see himself as an actor. And he was going through that transition. That's not an easy transition to be going through when you're 29 years old and you're doing an off-Broadway play and you're being paid $45 a week. You know, he's getting all kinds of pressure from home to do something with himself economically. And obviously he had all this potential. And, you know, sure enough, he dropped out.
In those days, everybody was writing, you know, Cafe La Mama, Cafe Chino,
just spawned a whole lot of writers. And Roy, I think, maybe began writing then.
Incredibly imaginative stuff. Everyone I've ever gone with has said, if that idiot can write, I surely can write too.
Roy did become a playwright, a produced New York playwright.
I think he felt under the shadow a lot of some of his more well-known playwright friends like Lanford Wilson.
Lanford was not only writing plays, he was not only getting plays produced, but he was getting famous.
We were lovers for about 3 years and then sort of drifted away and we just became friends.
I was already out here. I was staying at the Magic Hotel and Roy came out and it was a very, very tough time in his life because he kind of had it with New York. He wanted to change. He really didn't have very much money. He thought he'd come out here and reinvent himself.
In those days, he was really actively trying to become straight.
Very uncomfortable with his sexuality.
Like went to straight school.
I think he was going to a sex surrogate.
What he told me the reason was because he really wanted to be a dad.
I think it was just a tremendous yearning.
He wanted something in his life, and he hadn't met Tim. And that was a period where everybody was thinking, oh my God, maybe I should go straight and try to be having a family. And I think a lot of those people, there were a lot of people that did that at that time. And now they're all divorced and living with the men that they were waiting for.
That was an incredibly active thing he did by going to that surrogate. And I think it got him to a real honest place.
He was gravely afraid, ashamed of the fact that he was balding. So he would use this black spray paint and spray paint over his bald spot. And then he said he went out one night and he went to a bar and he was dancing and it was raining everywhere and he was laughing and everyone was laughing and pointing at him and he was having a great time and he felt like he was the life of the party. He got home and he went upstairs and as he was going to bed, he went into the bathroom and all the black paint in the rain had, and with him sweating, dancing, had dripped down over his face, and so that everyone had been laughing at him all night. He made a decision at that moment to stop hiding it.
I went to a benefit in the spring of 84. Roy was there, and for some reason, he started talking to me. I mean, and from that day until the day he died, give or take, you know, a few afternoons, he always said I was the love of his life.
That's the period where he just totally started to accept, this is who I am.
I think he took all the things that terrified him and that were secret and that he was, you know, kept way back here, and he embraced them in some way and moved forward with them. I mean, he embraced them and it freed him.
He changed so incredibly from when he was in New York to when he went to California. He changed 180 degrees. I mean, it was a completely different person. He was a shy, quiet, incredibly intelligent, but you never knew it because he never spoke. And when he went to California, everything changed. I mean, he bloomed under the sun.
When I work with actors, and risk of being a little pretentious, that when I work with actors, what I'm interested in is growth. I'm interested in change. And I'm not really as interested in acting as I am in people realizing their potential. And I've discovered in my life that I can have the best way I can realize my potential, I've tried some other ways, is through working with other people and helping them and seeing them do it.
Good acting, good art, is taking care of your personal problems in public. And his teaching was, to a large degree, a response to what he needed at that moment in his life.
He had that kind of energy that he had to keep learning. He had to keep growing, because what he taught his actors, you could see, it was his own journey in his own life, this seeking spirit. And every time you think you know, go back to I don't know, because I know is about ego. I don't know is about growth. And so everything he preached, he was battling to live in his life. I forget the acting. I believe all Roy was doing is just working out his own and our own acting life dilemmas through this craft. I think he was getting as much out of any session he did with me as I was, as a human being. And I think that's what made him special.
How he got into coaching or into teaching is that I, at the time, was dating Ivana Moore. And Ivana said to me, I just can't find the kind of teacher that really turns me on. I said, no, it's so funny because my roommate is Roy London. And when he teaches about acting, he incorporates Uta Hagen and various techniques. It really sounds wonderful to me. She got very, very turned on. And she said, oh, I really want to study with you. And he said, start me a class.
I studied with Uta Hagen too. I studied with her for years, just as Roy did. Uta Hagen's a great acting teacher.
She had this way of just finding exactly the right words at exactly the right time.
With him, he just made the stakes way higher.
Later on, when other teachers talked about him, they said, oh, Lenford, he has come up with entirely new theories of things that were twists on things that we've been doing all along, and he came up with entirely new, like in the moment, but in the moment today, not, you know, don't go back to your past. What happened to you today, you know, and just use today. And no one did that before.
He'd suggest that you choose to make the moment in the imaginary circumstance as much as possible, in some cases, like what was happening in life, so that you didn't have to act.
Acting in the sense that I'm using acting, I mean, and these are all, these terms kind of blend a little bit, is that you're acting out the story, that you get a line that says, I hate you, Lawrence. And it has a lot of exclamation marks. So what you do is you figure out ways to say it as hatefully as possible. You know, I hate you, Lawrence. And then someone says, well, think of your stepfather who beat you. Oh, that'll help you make it more exciting. And then I'm saying, well, what's going on the set? And how are you feeling about the person you're playing? And maybe it doesn't mean that you hate them. Maybe you're saying that because you love them and you don't know how to say you love them. So you say you hate that those. Who you are and what you're doing as a man or woman is more interesting than your interpretation of the line, if you will.
I have terrible anxiety about auditioning, terrible. I'm an actor, I'm insecure, we're all insecure, that's what we do. And like, and I also get really nervous. I would be great in my bathroom in front of the mirror, you know, and then I would get there and I would just break into a flop sweat. I would walk in the room and want everyone to like me.
Do you want to be friends with these people or do you want to work? I'm like, well, both. He goes, you can't have both.
And I would just choke. I would be terrible and meek. And, you know, Roy would say, and he said it to the class often, people are nervous. So you're nervous. So that becomes part of that character.
Why are you trying not to be nervous? I'm like, well, because then I can concentrate on the job. And he'd say, No, you're nervous. Then be nervous. Just give it up.
So you had a fight with your boyfriend, so you had a flat tire. Whatever your day has been, whatever you're experiencing, it's not about like sitting there and going, okay, this is the character I have to become. I have to relax. I have to relax every part of my body. I have to become not a human being so that I can then relax enough to channel some, you know, and that's kind of what I felt that I had been indoctrinated to believe.
He would send me his actors, especially, you know, very young actors. And I can't remember how it started, but we found out really quickly that we're on the same wavelength. A lot of the younger actors go into the audition to get validated by the people in the room so that their focus is not per se on the acting. Many times it's not even in getting the part, it's just about walking into the room and getting loved. For me, at least, training a young actor, the art of it was to bring their shadow into the room and take the risk of basically letting the shadow take over, which is again a horrifying almost leap of faith.
When you see a performer do something she or he has not done before, and this, if you're asking about being a movie star, and they are willing to let the camera roll while they are discovering this, let's be hypothetical. A woman has to be very sexy in a part, and the actress doesn't quite know whether she is that sexy. Maybe her friends tell her she is, or even the public, and she says, I'm going to find out in this scene. And I'm going to let the camera roll while I'm finding out. That's going to be beautiful. Meanwhile, maybe another woman says, oh, I have to be sexy in the scene. Let me go to study being sexy. I'll go to a dressmaker for sexy dress, to an acting coach for sexy acting, to this coach for sexy hair. And she figures it out. And then she does it right. And then she lets people film it. And it's good. I could be specific, but I'm not going to be. And it's good. Very good. But not interesting. Good. That's good. Do you see what I mean? If are you willing to discover something about what the script is about and yourself in the script while the camera, there's a camera here somewhere, while the camera's running? Are you willing to do that? Very few people are willing to do that. What most people would like to do is figure out how to do it right before that camera ever shows up. And be right, be the right thing. Trying to be the right thing while the camera's running is great, but having figured it out, and then, okay, camera, you can come now, and I'll show you how this character is. I'm just gonna, I've got it down perfectly. I promise you, does not a star make.
He would say whatever you were feeling that day was completely right for what what you would bring to the character, that it really wasn't that difficult.
If you just show up, if you really show up, you are what they want.
The other week saw Niagara, and I saw Marilyn Monroe, and she has a ticket, a Greyhound ticket, and she goes to this rather avuncular clerk and says, may I trade this in? She needs cash. Joseph Cotton's chasing her. She needs some money. He says, yes, you can get $21, or whatever it is, and she says, thank you, and that's the scene. Now, her acting is not good, but her movie acting is sublime, because I think what she's playing, may I trade this in, is to this avuncular day player, an actor who lived in the Valley and worked for the studio and worked every week and was probably rather secure in that he would have a job. She's saying in that line, help me. The character is saying, help me with the line, can I trade this in for cash? But Marilyn Monroe, I believe, is saying to this day player, I'm nervous, I don't know if I'm acting right, can you help me? But the line is, can I trade this in for money? And so the depth of that, that's her vision. Her vision is, help me, how do I do this right? What do I do to be the right kind of woman? And that's filmed, and it's exciting, and acting is irrelevant. It's glorious, but it hurt her. She was needed that at every moment. I'm sure she needed it off camera, I didn't know her, on camera, and afterwards. I would rather that an actor choose, I'm going to look at what I am as a woman here for today, and then I'm going to go home and stay alive.
Yeah? Roy gave you the tools to do that, to strip away and be yourself.
So if business, or whatever's going on the set, or how you're being treated, or whatever practical thing is bothering you that day, that's plenty to start a scene from. Bring that right into the scene. I do that a lot. That helps me a lot whenever I work with someone who really intimidates me. I particularly felt it with Gene Hackman or a few others, Harvey Keitel or whoever. Somebody I find confronting or scary. Roy would always say, good, that character then is very scared of that person. Go from there.
If you can't figure out what it is, go around the corner, walk your dog, and I'll never forget, oddly, he said, have a Coke and think, what do I want today? What do I want today? And that's what the scene is about. That's what the script is about. And it's weird, but having worked now, you know, almost every day for years, and working when you're sick and when you're tired and when you're uninspired and depressed and bored, really that's the only thing that works.
He goes, you're very raw, and that's going to be the thing that's going to enable you to work, and it's going to separate you from all the other blonde actresses out there. He goes, you've got a grittiness about you, and sure enough, everyone tried to change me, to make me into someone like my sister, Michelle Pfeiffer, who's more, you know, coiffed and all that kind of stuff. And God bless her, but that's her, and I'm so not. And he'd be like, he goes, and don't let them make you into her, or anybody else for that matter. He said, just harness and own who you are.
It used to drive him crazy that he'd see people being so vivacious as human beings, and then they would get very stiff and rigid as actors.
He didn't want people to be less than who they were and who they could be. He was passionate about that.
I said a few times to different students, you're a much more interesting person than you are an actor.
Say, I saw you outside talking to your friends, smoking your cigarette, flipping your hair, and now you're here boring, doing nothing.
And he'd say, okay, now start your scene. and they'd sort of get into, and I'm sure I was totally guilty of this too, like sort of get into, okay, now I'm going to do the scene, and he'd go, no, I don't want you to do that. I want, go from, you're a more interesting person than what you're about to do by acting, so just don't.
That was very scary, because that's what would be rejected, was all of me. If I could be somebody else, then they were rejecting this facade.
It was incredibly empowering what he was doing with us. He was trying to get us to be more of who we are.
If that's something you choose to do, you'll see what the essence of this man or woman was. You know, they were talking about Gary Cooper the other day in class. Someone had asked me, and I said, you know, I think what Gary Cooper was, that Gary Cooper is not that he knew he was going to win, but he knew he wasn't going to give up until he did, which is very different. And that's what's so exciting about him. And then you look at his career and you say, this guy really didn't have any roles of any substance till he was 40. And that's how he lived his life. He hung in there, and I'm going to be there. And that may be, in the long run, as strong, if not even a stronger way to be as a human being than knowing you're going to win. That I'm going to hang in here until I take care of what I've got to take care of, whether it be love or the villain, or I'm going to take care of it. And if it takes a day, a year, 5 years, 10 years, this man is there. I'd like to spend time with someone like that if I had a choice.
He had a fantastic way of imparting his own passion to others. That's the other stuff. There's intangible stuff that he was able to impart.
There are things that each of us do that no one does like us. I had an example of that from the scene class. There was a scene that that Sharon Stone was doing. She was scurrying to fix herself up, and instead of doing what maybe, you know, kind of a high school actor might do, maybe take out a powder puff and, you know, something like that, Sharon took this can of spray, hairspray, and did this mad kind of tornado with this hairspray out in the world, and then ran through it in a kind of wacky, fuzzy hair dance. It did this thing to her hair. It was so specific and unique to that actress at that moment. And again and again and again, Roy brought out these kind of behaviors that just took your breath away.
Every person, clearly, he dealt with totally differently. Every person he looked at who they were and found a space for how to communicate with them.
I remember there was an actress in the class who will remain nameless, and all of us felt that she didn't really belong in the class, that she really wasn't quite up to the Tuesday night class. And she did a scene that week, and she was awful in the scene. And Roy was just praising her and saying how wonderful she was in the scene. And all of us in the class were feeling really uncomfortable about this. And so after the scene was over, I approached Roy, you know, down the hallway, and I said, I don't get it. You know, I'm really confused. I don't even know if I should be in the class anymore, because here's this terrible performance, and you just said how wonderful she was. And he looked at me shocked and said, do you think that I have an obligation to tell the truth? My obligation is to make you a better actor, no matter what I use to do that. And if telling her she's good when she wasn't is going to make her better, then I'm doing my job. And I was so stunned by it, but pleased by the honesty of it, that it really made me realize that he was onto something else. And that actress ended up becoming one of the best in the class.
Interesting scripts are about people who are, what should I be? How can I change the world? How can I have dinner? Or how can I cure this disease? Or how can I straighten out all these finances? People are looking for, how can I be someone who can be more virile and have more of a sense of power? And that means there are a lot of women who are looking at that in a different way than maybe it's been looked at before.
I loved women. He got us.
You could really see it. I mean, I could take you on a little guided tour and say, oh, there's a London student over there. There's a Roy London. She's a Roy London actress, and you know, you could tell.
You had a special kind of thing if you got to coach with him as a woman.
He delivered a lot of actresses to the public in their best form.
I would run into problems with directors. No, 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 don't do it that way. We want it this way. We want it this way. He'd say, well, as a girl, you can go, yes, yes, okay, you know. I am trying to do it that way, and just keep doing it your own way.
He tried to make you director-proof, which means, I mean, he has a lot of respect for directors, and I obviously worked with some incredibly talented and wonderful directors. But if it comes a time when you are going to be in conflict, and what the director tells you isn't useful, but in fact kind of puts you in a direction you don't want to go, he wanted to make you director-proof. Let's say they were keen that the director was keen that you should cry in this scene, and we had decided it's definitely wrong, that you don't feel that way, you don't cry. And they insist, and you're going to get in a fight otherwise over this, and you don't want to do that. He'd say, well, is there a way that you could pretend to cry because it gives your character a tool to use? You know, the character's not really crying, but your character decides to pretend to cry because it might affect them. And so it's a completely subtle difference that nobody else is going to understand, but I will. I know what I'm playing, and it makes me feel more real.
To play less than a man, it's degrading, and you feel it. So, you know, he created a sense of nobility within you.
We worked on a film I did called Ruby together, and I played a stripper in it. One of the hardest parts, ironically, was doing these strips. I hated it. And I hated just being reduced to this eye candy. And I remember calling Roy, crying right before I was supposed to go and do this. And I didn't think I could do it and whatever. And he just said, he was quiet for a minute, and he said, honey, what if the audience is a bunch of terminally ill men that, you know, are getting kind of some joy out of watching you dance? It's just like, okay, bye, Roy. Click. And it switched everything.
A lot of times the mother role or the female role on a sitcom tends to be underwritten.
I had no role, and I was having a horrendous time. And this friend of mine, Chris Noe, said, well, you get a coach. And I'd actually never worked with a coach before. And I said, well, how can that help? And he said, it'll make a difference. At least you'll have a partner in the thing.
Half the time, they don't even know if you have a job. You know, you're just the woman. You know, you're just the mom. And then maybe eventually they'll throw a couple of things in about, okay, well, today you're a real estate agent. You know, we've decided because we want to do an episode about that.
And then when I came in to meet him, he said, okay, you're right, there isn't a role. So there's no way you're going to get out of this life. However, we can do something so that it will be fulfilling for you.
There wasn't a lot for me to do in the Twin Peaks pilot. It was 2 hours, and I was, you know, only had a couple minutes of actual screen time. And I think as a result of the work I was doing with Roy, my role kept getting bigger and bigger on the show. And what was interesting was that Roy was noticing that other people on the show were doing what they thought I was doing. And you never, what the result is never what you're working on. People would think you're playing sexy or you're playing, and he's like, did we ever work on playing sexy? Never. You know, it's like having a very specific focus and purpose, and then maybe as a result of that, something else happens.
Women have been led to believe that being confident about being powerful is inappropriate. And that when we are confident in our power, we are asked to apologize over and over and over again.
When Katharine Hepburn became box office poison, that after she had been a star and then she couldn't, her movies didn't make money, that every movie since when she made her comeback has a character in it that puts her down. So instead of pulling back on what maybe people considered abrasive, she did not do that. But she brought into the picture a character who said, you're abrasive. So rather than pander, oh, people didn't like her because she was that strong and that kind of willful, she just brought in someone. So she didn't have to change.
It was important for him, for us to be warriors.
I want you to go out there and change
the way people see. They're 30 years behind what's really going on. They don't see middle-aged women like you. They wouldn't see you as a mother, even though you're a mother. They don't allow mothers to be wild, sexy, powerful. They wouldn't want your wisdom in there. You know, that old person you're becoming. And you and all those others like you out there, who are in your 40s and in your 50s, need to go out and change the consensus's view.
He really wanted women to make this mass move, I think, as actresses, into this more powerful stance. He would talk about the time when Betty Davis and all these other women were powerful.
I think if you look back and you look at some Barbara Stanwyck, if you look at Barbara Stanwyck, now you think she's beautiful because she became a movie star, but this isn't Betty Davis. They are gorgeous, but they're gorgeous because we've seen them change and we've seen them be present and we've seen them have the courage and the guts to do something that may not have been acceptable at that time.
He would talk about looking at parts and not necessarily having to play the part that was written for the woman. Trying to get to a place in your career where you have some power and saying, I want to play that detective's part, that guy's part, that's the one that I want to play.
To get women to do power scenes, he'd often have to give them scenes that were written for men because there are very few scenes written for powerful women. So a lot of women in class would end up doing a Glengarry Glen Ross.
We did Glengarry Glen Ross. I came in, I did that like a girl. You know, I wanted to be seductive. I wanted to be charming. All these things that I thought were acceptable power. He made me have to understand power in another way. I had to deal with doing it right, which was to look at that person across the table like they were a rat in a maze. And I was gonna back them down and back them down and back them down and back them into that corner till I had them back in that damn corner. And then when I got them back in the corner, I had the cheese. And they weren't getting out of that corner. And they weren't getting the cheese until they were doing what I told them to do. And that's how it was going down, and that was how it was gonna be. Now that's a lot for a woman to do, because we aren't raised like that, and we aren't told that's okay.
I left that class, and 6 weeks later I got Basic Instinct. And it's no mystery how.
Did you kill Mr. Boz, Ms. Trammell?
I'd have to be pretty stupid to write a book about killing and then kill somebody the way I described it in my book. I'd be announcing myself as the killer. I'm not stupid.
I'll tell you what I suggest to some women I know, is to look at yourself as a woman sooner. Let girlhood, take a look at the kind of woman you're becoming. I think it's really interesting on the screen to watch someone who isn't yet a mature woman finding out what it is like.
When I started with him, I was just kind of finding myself and sexuality and all of that, and I would come to him just fully done, like makeup and hair and heels, and maybe also because I was younger, I wanted to project some older image, but a lot of it was a mask so that people wouldn't really see who it was. And sometimes I'd come over to his house, and no matter what, there'd be a washcloth. Probably kill me if you saw me right now. I'm wearing a little lip gloss, but mascara. But it's for camera, so it's okay. But in life, he kept trying to make me shed this whole kind of thing I had created. And it was really hard to trust because I really kind of felt like without it, I didn't know what was under there.
Yep. He was the first person that I respected in my life that was a grown-up man who had no agenda except to empower me.
So he'd have a washcloth and soap waiting, and he would not work with me till I went to the bathroom and washed my face off. And literally, his whole thing was just, let's see who's really there, not what you've been validated for, maybe, but what's real. And once we find that, then you can bring that into the world and into your work.
I remember one script in particular which we liked, but we wanted to make the woman more of a hero, and they were very much against it.
Roy London was having an effect on actresses that the public didn't know about, but that they were benefiting by.
He said, we so don't need any more images of women out there that are so bad that they need to be destroyed, and Hollywood will do so. And Like halfway through Thelma and Louise, you knew for the first third, like, they're not going to let these women live. And I know that was something you worked on. You said, yeah, so we had fun with it, but you knew they weren't going to let them.
Thelma and Louise, he called it intimacy. That my character knows nothing about it. I fake it, I avoid it, and at the end, I get it. You know, that the idea is that I die in the end, but it's been so worth it. My notes about deciding to drive off the cliff are all about utter joy and fulfillment, you know, and which is great. And I don't know that I would I have come up with that myself?
Certainly by the late 80s, it was all kicking in. And a lot of the heroines that we saw, Geena Davis, Sharon Stone, Michelle Pfeiffer, a lot of the heroines that we saw in that time were very, very influenced by Roy London's coaching and his inspiration and his devotion to empowering women.
I had gotten into the advanced class, and there was Sharon Stone was in there at that point in time, and there were about 12 or 14 of us. And I call that kind of the pre-Geena. And then there was the post-Geena.
I was watching the Academy Awards at a party, and Geena Davis thanked him.
My wonderful acting coach, Roy London.
And I went, well, I'll never get up to do a scene again now.
The classes just ballooned. I mean, 2 weeks later, there was 24 people in there, and then they got to be 48 people.
I talked to him the next day, of course, and he said, oh, that was so amazing that you mentioned my name and thanked me. He said, I got 150 messages on my machine, and then it broke. There were so many messages, and I was like, oh, that's great. I got about 25, yeah. It was a big day. I was like, I won the thing. Roy had felt very strongly that it was a good move to play the stronger character, Louise, the part I didn't play. So I was selling Ridley on this. I had stacks of notes, hours of notes. At the end, he says, so in other words, you wouldn't play Thelma. I paused, recall a second, and I said, well, actually, here's why. Now that you mentioned it, I should play Thelma. I called Roy, I said, oh my God, I think he wants me to play Thelma. He said, okay, well, that's fine. Well, that's great, you know, you can do that too. I was hired for the movie with the agreement that I would play either part, depending on who they got for the other actress. When it turned out to be Susan, it made so much sense that she be Louise.
Thelma, what are you doing?
Smoking.
Hey. I'm Louise.
Brad auditioned because I asked Roy if he knew any actress who should audition for the part, because I knew they were looking for somebody.
You were sure genuinely about it.
Well, now, I've always believed if done properly, armed robbery doesn't have to be a totally unpleasant experience. What?
You're a real live outlaw, aren't you?
Well, I may be an outlaw, darling, but you're the one stealing my heart.
I remember Brad Pitt in the class before he was Brad Pitt.
And Roy would say, you know, I'm scrubbing the white out of the white bread. Because Brad was this kid from, I think he's like from the Midwest or... And he was just this gorgeous, gorgeous, sweet kid.
I read with the young fellows who were auditioning for that part, and he was amazing. He was amazing. I mean, I was obviously looking out for who's the one that Roy talked about, but he was dazzling.
You know, Roy, you know, just got him to that point where he wasn't. He was multidimensional. I don't know how else to explain it.
Absolutely loose and freewheeling, and whatever happened was fine with him.
Very few acting teachers had any success taking a comedian to an actor's place. Very difficult transition. Carey Shandling, great example of that. Roy helping someone with that transition.
A writer friend of mine who was writing on Laverne and Shirley, of all things, somehow knew of Roy and had been in his class and said, this is the guy you should study with. Roy would come to the show once a week and work for about half a day on the script with me, and my scenes with me, which often influenced the writing, and then I would change the writing because I could. So it was a really fascinating process, because from the acting coach would come writing changes. We looked at it every stage, from the script to a rehearsal to the final cut.
My part was I was kind of annoying him all the time and kind of driving him crazy and stuff. And Roy had this way of approaching that, which was so positive. I mean, there's sort of no such thing as a bad guy in Roy's vocabulary, because my character needed to drive his character crazy, because his character was stuck.
My guest tomorrow, Alec Baldwin, Ed Begley Jr.,
yeah.
And Katie Lang.
He'll be a good guy.
Yeah, he'll be a good guest, maybe. I don't know. I don't think he's ever been on the show before.
No, he'll be good. He's very funny. I know him, you know.
You know Alec Baldwin? I didn't know
Alec
Baldwin.
You know him, too. Remember we met him that time with the charity ball we used
Which
to go?
Which one?
I don't know.
Cystic fibrosis?
No, it wasn't muscular dystrophy, but
Lupus?
It was like that. No.
Was it the Asthma Foundation?
It was multiple sclerosis. Multiple sclerosis benefit.
Yeah.
And I met him there, and then he called me up after we got divorced, and we went out.
Well, he's gay, you know.
He's not gay.
He's gay.
I can tell you he's definitely
gayer than a French horn.
Gay.
I can tell you he's hugely gay.
I had sex with him. Is that going to be a problem for you? As a director, he just thought you were glorious as an actor, just glorious, and everything was hilarious that you did. And so that just would open you up so that you would just think, all right, you know, wait till you see this one, Roy.
Certainly always willing to be first supportive and go, great, 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 that's great, that's great, that's great, that's great, that's great, that's great. It usually was when I wasn't on the screen.
You don't want him on the show. I've seen this kind of thing before. You're interviewing him, you're laughing along with Alec Baldwin, and then you blink, and you see him screwing your lovely Francine. You see her face. You see his face slobbering in her ear. You see the legs all entangled. You hear the grunts.
All right. If I cancel him, don't I look like a jerk? Come on. Really, the Larry Sanders Show, as odd as it is that it won an Emmy for writing, and I think the writing was fantastic, I think it was really designed and driven by the actors, and the other actors on the show would, I think, agree with that. I'm sorry, Alec, they're still hooting from my monologue. Nice to have you here. And
great to be here.
I enjoyed you a lot in Glengarry Glen Ross.
Thank just you. A wonderful
And tell me what you've been doing lately.
Well, actually, Larry, you know, you and I have something in common.
Yes. Yes, we do. A lot of you probably don't know that Alec and I, Alec used to actually date my ex-wife, Francine.
No, I was referring to our charity work with multiple sclerosis.
I know that, too. Let's take a little commercial break, and we'll come right back with more of Alec Baldwin.
I knew when Carey Shandling put Roy's name as the final credit on his show. I know what a comic means by that. I mean, that's it. It wasn't Gary's name last, it was Roy's.
I remember his 50th birthday party vividly.
And I remember it being this gigantic, over-the-top birthday party. I couldn't understand why he would throw a birthday party for himself like that.
In a ballroom with a band.
I remember him in his gold shoes.
They were gold leaf, right?
Yeah.
You know, they're real gold. To my mind, that's a metaphor for this, the way he conducted himself. I mean, who wears gold shoes?
Everybody kind of took a turn in the middle dancing with Roy.
Wild dancing. I'd never seen him do it before.
Big.
big, huge, unadulterated grin on his face.
And later, when I heard that, in fact, he'd been sick at that time, I just couldn't believe it.
And I remember at the end of the night, him coming up to me and just hugging me really tight, like he just didn't want to let go. And, you know, I thought, oh, that's cute. He's really happy to turn 50. That's great.
I thought, wow, 50. 50's all right.
But it all didn't make sense to me until later. And then I realized that was his goodbye.
I'll never forget the day he called me and said, come over. It was a Saturday. I have something to tell you. And sat me down in his living room and told me he had AIDS.
In September of 89, we were tested, and he was positive, and I wasn't, which was, I don't recommend that. Certainly one of the worst moments in my life. I hope to never have to sit in a room and experience a moment where you're completely torn apart from someone. You know, just this big hole opened up between us. We had never fathomed that we would get split down the middle like that. And we started working together. And I think the intensity of his work really changed at that point.
Every class seemed important.
He became less tolerant of people being lazy, of people not reaching their potential.
I didn't know this. You know, I didn't know he was HIV. I didn't realize how precarious his situation was. But I did feel it was important.
His hiding being positive was not so much about shame or anything. He just did not want to be perceived as a sick person or a disadvantaged person or to utilize it in any manner for sympathy. He just didn't want that at all.
He said, I'm having some problems with my back. And I said, oh, I'm so sorry. And he said, but I'm gonna be fine. It's gonna be fine. And Tim and I are planning a trip. We're gonna go on the QE2 to England. It's gonna be fabulous.
That determination, he was like, he got on the phone and got a travel agent and organized a boat trip to England.
He said he was taking a vacation and then he never came back.
He was determined to set sail, you know. He was taking a voyage. But he didn't get to the QE2.
And we were to go hide in London, and it's England. You can get the chemo there, you know. And the doctor said, sure, you can get chemo there. And I mean, this is a guy who can't get out of the bed.
And after that, it went really fast.
I was watching, an award show. And Sharon Stone won an award.
I learned almost everything I know about life, and certainly everything I know about acting from my great friend and my teacher. Who is so special to me, Roy London.
And she burst out in tears. And right then I knew what was happening. Something was really wrong with Roy, and that made all the phone calls.
He needed all of his energy for himself at that time. And he was driven to teach, and he was driven to give.
He didn't have many of his students come to visit him. And he said to me, which I think is so telling, he said, I have nothing to give them right now. So he wasn't even then thinking of taking. And I'll never forget that.
He had to be around people who he knew understood the process of dying and or being ill, and that he didn't have to perform for them in any way. And that's why I was there, because he knew that I had had some experience. Just to digress for a moment, in 1979, I had a brother who died of Hodgkin's disease. I was a platelet match, so I would go to Texas every 10 days to give platelets. And this one particular time, I had a dream. I was standing in a corridor with all these doors, and there was a little couple there and a little boy. And I took a pill, and I flew up, and he wanted to know how I'd done it. And I didn't really know how I'd done it, but I showed him, and he flew away. But there was this corridor with all these doors that went into infinity. There was no ceiling. It was just like a hospital corridor with all these doors. And I got from this dream that I was supposed to help my brother, and I did. And I observed a lot of things about the process of dying. Tim had nurses around the clock, but he really didn't want Roy to be by himself. So one of us would be there when he couldn't be there.
I didn't want to be alone, because we're all, the whole time he'd been sick, and really for his life, I was someone who could eat his fear. I could take it away with a joke or a thing. And so the whole time he was in the hospital, I was able to keep his fear away. And I never left his side for the last 2 months, really, for more than an hour or two.
I saw him while you know, I don't recall exactly, but every few days as he was passing away, and talked to him quite intimately about life and death and love. And
one day I went there, and he was lying in bed, and they were checking his vital signs, and he was saying, "I have to find an end to this movie. I have to find an end to this movie." And Tim was with me, and he said, "I've just got to find an end to this movie." He kind of left his body, and it seemed like he died. And I held him for like a minute, and I thought he was dead. And then I got very, very excited, because of course I have this huge ego. I thought, he picked me to die with. He trusts me so much, and we're so close, and he picked me to die with. I really did. I was like, oh my God, he died with me. And I got all kind of like loopy, like, I'm holding Roy in this beautiful moment, and it's like, and I got kind of like, oh, you know, because you could feel this kind of like otherworldliness in the room. And it was like this really intense kind of God energy, and this kind of really like absence in the body. And then all of a sudden there was this, and he was like back in his body. And he went, like that, kind of like, whoa. And he went, I know. I'm like, and I was so shocked. And he was like, I know what it's all about. And he started this kind of intense, I understand, I have to teach another class. I know. And then, and I was so freaked out, because I was like, fuck. You know, because I was like, oh, he's back. He's like, oh, I didn't die. Oh my God, it's not me. Oh, oh my God, I didn't know. I was like, shit. You know, and suddenly, and he was so, and he had this patch on his eye, because he couldn't close his eye, and it was suddenly started tearing again, and he was like, and we were so discombobulated, you know, and it was like, he's, I'm like, okay, what? And he said, it's about love. It's about love. Sharon, it's all about love. Because, you know, he used to say it was bad. They were about love scenes, and they were about power, and they were about, it's not about any of that. They're all about love.
Well, you're getting into spiritual things. You know, why would somebody condense his life's work into saying that it's about love? One way, the way I look at it is just as the person's dying and they're getting closer to the spiritual world, in many cases they become less afraid of death, and death becomes less real. Power becomes totally unreal because it's no longer relevant. So you could say love is the only thing that's left.
I have to teach another class. I'm like, okay, Roy, okay. But he was like, you know, 70 pounds maybe, you know, and just like a skeleton.
The last thing Roy said to me about acting was, I am telling you, he mumbled in between going in and out, a couple weeks before he passed away. He said, I'm telling you, it's all about love. And when he said it, it was really connected to what love is. It wasn't like just saying it. And every choice, he said, every acting choice should come from a place of love. And you could feel that, how honest that was and how connected it was. And that's the last thing I remember speaking to him about acting. And I think that had he been in class teaching at that point, that would have gone somewhere and would have been, not that he didn't always believe that, but I'm sure towards the end he saw it in some new way.
I said, Roy, I agree with you 100%. You have to find an end to this movie. And I really support you. I totally support you in finding an end. I really want you to find an end to it. And I think I know how. And I didn't know what I was talking about. I just said, I think if we just lie here and we just breathe, I think we'll find an end. So I lay down beside him, and we just sort of went into a trance. And he got very still and very quiet, and we lay there for probably an hour. And Tim and the doctor, whoever was there, came in and checked his vital signs, and he got hysterical again. And as soon as they left, I said, Roy, remember where we were? Let's go back to that place. Can we go back to the place where we were? And he said, oh, you mean the corridor with all the doors? I mean, I was stunned. I said, yeah, the corridor with all the doors. And he said, right. And then the elevator's there, then I'll just get in the elevator and I'll just go on up and then I'll just wait for you, right? And I said, yeah, that's it. So we lay down, and this was a man on heavy morphine. And 15 minutes later, he turned over to me, looked at me on there, and pressed me on the side like that. And I looked over at him, and he said, totally lucid, you know, I really appreciate this. And I said, I know you do, Roy. The nurse that was there, named Nurse Lynn, I'll never forget her. I sat back down with Roy, and she said, so you understand the language of the soul? And I said, I don't know. And she said, who was your teacher? And I said, I guess it was my brother. And she said, because, you know, I have to write on here delirious, but you and I know what's really going on. Which was amazing, amazing confirmation. And so he started making his way, and I think he died maybe the next morning. And they called me to tell me that he was going. And when I drove through from Santa Monica through Beverly Hills, and by the time I hit Beverly Hills, I felt him go. And I felt his spirit soaring over the city. He was such a strong force. I could just feel him. And when I got there, he had just gone. And we bathed him. We wrapped him in white cloth. And took him up to Santa Barbara and buried him by the sea.
I laughed at the tissues, but
everyone laughs.